earlier this week, we took a look at which teams had the best opportunity to make the Big 12 championship next year. And yeah, while I think that a lot of teams within the Big 12 will be improved from what we saw last year going into this year, I still think that there's primarily three teams that have the best chance to make it, with OU being not only the overwhelming favorite to make it, but the overwhelming favorite to win it and then go on to the college football playoffs. That team is absolutely loaded with talent, not only in guys who chose to return, but transfers coming in, plus a really nice recruiting class. But with all that, I want to turn our attention to the SEC, because I think the SEC could be in for an interesting year, and I want to hear from you. Do you think that it's as simple this year that the SEC West representative will be Alabama and the SEC East representative in the SEC championship will be Georgia? If you think so, give me a Y for yes and an N for no, and let me know why you agree or disagree, and then let me know if you think there are any dark horses within the SEC. Guys, if you enjoy the video, drop a like. Likes and comments go a long ways on smaller channels like mine, get picked up by the YouTube algorithm, and we have been absolutely killing it on the growth, and I cannot thank y'all enough for that. If you've subscribed to the channel, like I said, thank you so much. And if you haven't, go ahead and subscribe. Hit the bell notification. I do constant college football content, whether it be player reviews, film reviews, or talk style videos like this, and I'd love to have you along for the journey. But with all that being said, let's hop straight into it. Because the SEC is in for one of the more interesting transitions of recent memory. Sure, we're used to a mass talent exodus out the SEC, and sure, coaching changes are like a revolving door in the Southeastern Conference. But the magnitude at which talent was lost this year is pretty staggering, right? Like, the SEC was incredibly talented. Really, for the past 3 years, they've been just loaded with talent, and now we've seen it kind of come to a head. And sure, while there's plenty of talent on the back end within the SEC, a lot of it is very inexperienced, and I think that that's going to come and really affect some teams. And I'd kind of like to start with the SEC East. The SEC East last year was really a two-team showdown between Florida and Georgia. And for those of you that are SEC East fans, I surely hope that you're a Georgia fan, because if you're not, I don't see any path for anyone else to really make it out the SEC East. Look, Missouri looks to continue on to the season they had last year, which was actually pretty good. I think Missouri will be an improved team. I think a lot of the teams within the SEC are going to improve, but Georgia returns a smorgasbord of talent. I mean, they are really, really deep, and JT Daniels and Munkin look to have something really special going on, and JT Daniels finished the season on a real big high, playing in a lot of big games and playing really well in those games, right? I think Georgia returns a ton of talent. They lose some talent in their secondary, but even then, they return just enough, and it's Georgia. We know they're going to have a good defense. I'm not really too worried about replacing the talent in the secondary. I'd be much more worried if Florida returned Kadarius Toney, Kyle Pitts, and Trask, but they don't, right? And when I look at the SEC East, I just don't see a team who's in a good position to really say anything to Georgia. Florida didn't return enough people, and you know they're going to be very talented at running back next year with the Clemson transfer coming in, Bowman. The kid's going to be a stud. But the problem is it's almost a year too late, right? Like, if they would have had him with Kyle Trask, Kyle Pitts, and Kadarius Toney, we might be talking about some different results within the SEC, at least as it pertains to what games Florida loses outside of Bama. Even with him, I don't think they were beating Bama. But, hey, they might have won every other game but Bama if they had Bowman. Missouri, I don't think, can make enough strides. Tennessee, they need to figure out what they have going in Rocky Top, because the Burger Boys are just cashing out over there. South Carolina is in a precarious situation, as always. South Carolina will South Carolina. Vanderbilt and Kentucky. I mean, Kentucky looks to continue improving, right? And Vanderbilt is Vandy. I don't think much more needs to be said about the SEC East. The real intrigue comes out the SEC West. Now, I'm going to go ahead and get it out the way. If I had to predict, it would be Alabama, and I'm going to tell you why. First off, I think that the teams with the best opportunity within the SEC West are probably Alabama, LSU, and really that's it. And it's not that I don't think that any of the other teams are going to be good. I think A&M's going to be very good. But A&M lost three out of their four starting linemen that were seniors. And this was a line that only gave up four sacks, right? And look, Bama lost a lot of talent, but I'll tell you where they returned a ton of talent, and that's along the defensive front, where they have guys looking to bear down on quarterbacks, right? Will Anderson led the SEC in sacks as a true freshman, led the nation in quarterback hurries, and oh yeah, by the way, now he's going to have a full offseason in that program, a full season in the strength and conditioning program, and he's on time with college football now. Losing line next season is going to be a big detriment to A&M, who otherwise has talent elsewhere, but I don't think it's enough talent to be able to capitalize against an Alabama. Look, Alabama lost a bunch of talent. There's no shaking this any other way. But they also are loaded with five stars on the back end. Bryce Young looks to be the heir apparent, former number one quarterback in the nation. They have a bunch of five-star running backs just waiting to go. And the defense looks to reload with multiple big-time players coming in and guys who were contributing last year, right? Like, we saw Malachi Moore step up as a freshman, Brian Branch step up as a freshman. Those kind of players right there stepping up really give credence to why I think Alabama can come out the SEC West. And as much as it pains me to say it, the other team that I think probably has the best opportunity is an LSU. LSU was terrible last year, but here's the advantage I give LSU over a lot of other teams, such as a Mississippi State and an A&M. LSU knows what they have to work for next year, right? They know what their program is going to look like, where A&M is going to have to do a lot of overhaul. Now, the reason why I don't think LSU is going to win it, and I don't think that LSU will really be able to challenge Alabama next year, I could be wrong on this, right? I very well could be, but I don't think they will be, is because I think there's way too much turmoil at the top at LSU, and I think that it hasn't even come to a head yet. I've talked about the turmoil at LSU. I don't think that that program is sitting well right now, and I don't think Ed O has complete control of it, because we have word that they may have some more big-time guys transferring out. So while LSU is in an advantage because they got a very real look at themselves, and they know what they need to work on, that is an advantage over in Alabama where there's question marks. The disadvantage is you knew it wasn't very good, right? At Alabama, you are thinking that what's going to come in is going to be pretty good. At LSU, you know what you have, and it wasn't good enough this year, right? I mean, it just wasn't good enough. Ole Miss is an interesting team, but Ole Miss, I don't feel like, has the defense to really be able to seriously contend. Great offensive team. No doubt about that. Great offensive team. But just like I said, Alabama returns a ton of talent on defense. They lose a ton of talent on defense. Guys like Dylan Moses, Patrick Surtain. But the reason I'm comfortable with Alabama is because Dylan Moses already went down and was out a full year. Alabama was able to develop a linebacker behind him who didn't even start this year. And while the Patrick Surtain loss certainly hurts, it really helps when you have guys like Brian Branch, Malachi Moore, all playing and balling as true freshmen. And then when you add in the number one cornerback in the nation coming into this class, DeQuincy McKinstry, plus the number two JUCO corner in the nation, Kyree Jackson, you have to like where Alabama's chances are at coming out the SEC West, because A&M's going to take a big hit. Mississippi State's going to take a big hit. Auburn is kind of in that same situation as LSU right now, except it's a controlled variation. Auburn could be very good next year, but I think it's going to take them a little bit to kind of build the program that they want as opposed to the team they want. And Arkansas, look, I think Arkansas actually will be a much improved team, just like we saw they were much improved last year. But much improved relative to Arkansas, not much improved relative to the rest of the SEC, so they will still have a long ways to go, but they will be a better Arkansas squad because they are very well coached. So, in the end, I think that it's kind of a boring year in the SEC in the sense that it's going to be a Bama-Georgia SEC championship. Guys, as I said in the beginning, let me know what you think down in the comments if you think whether or not Alabama and Georgia are going to inevitably meet in the SEC championship. Can't wait to hear from y'all. Like the video, subscribe, that way you can see all of my content. That's it. See ya.